I love to tell the story of unseen things above, of Jesus and His glory, of Jesus and His love. I love to tell the story because I know 'tis true. It satisfies my longings as nothing else can do.
It is good to give God thanks, to sing praises to the Most High. We will sing with joy to God who has made us glad. Let us declare God's steadfast love in the morning and God's faithfulness by night. So come to worship God with thankful, joyful hearts. Let us praise God's holy name. Welcome to worship. With us once again from Cornerstone Church in Tara, from Westminster in Paisley, and to everyone else from everywhere who is joining us today. I'd like to thank those who have helped with today's service, to Jan for the recording and editing once again, and to Amanda for help with hymns, and Amanda also for special music, and to Daryl and Christine for special music today. Remember, please, to continue to be as careful and stay as safe as you possibly can. Even as we begin to open up the province, it's still very important that we are careful, take all precautions that we can, and continue to pray for one another. Let us begin our worship today with prayer. Living God, from you comes vitality, love, and joy. Your peace is our companion, your love is our strength, your Son is our hope. In even our darkest moments, your presence brings comfort. Hidden deep in the soil of life, your Spirit nurtures tiny seeds of purpose and potential to surprise us with new life. Like the earth beginning to bloom around us, so your kingdom unfolds to surprise us with new possibilities. We bring you our prayers and praise this day, trusting that your Spirit will bring us the gifts that we need to serve you in faithfulness, renewed by your love through Christ our Lord. Living, loving God, as we watch growth in our gardens and in the children around us, we confess that we often resist growth and change as we grow older. We form ideas and opinions about many things and we cling to them. We think we already know what you desire from us, and we fear new insights and new directions. Forgive us for thinking that we already know it all. Forgive us for blocking out the concerns and commitments of those who differ from us. Open our eyes, our ears, and our hearts to signs of new life. Grant us faith like the mustard seed, so small and insignificant on its own, yet able to grow with your blessing to become a mighty sign of your kingdom among us. Amen. Hear the good news. Who is in a position to condemn? Only Christ. And Christ died for us. Christ rose for us. Christ reigns in power for us. Christ prays for us. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Rejoice in God's good gift.
eternal, unchanging, we sing to your praise. Your mercies are endless and righteous your ways. Your servants proclaim the renown of your name. O sovereign, omnipotent, ever the same. Again we rejoice in the world you have made. Your mighty creation in beauty arrayed. We thank you for life and we praise you for joy, for love and for hope that no power can destroy. We praise you for Jesus, our Savior and Lord, the might of his Spirit, the truth of his word. Give comfort in sorrow and patience in pain, the faith sure and steadfast that Jesus shall reign.
Our first reading today comes from Paul's letter to the church in Corinth. Paul had a rather rocky relationship with the Corinthian church, but he kept trying over and over again to bring them to new life through faith. He starts today's passage dealing with the subject of mortality. Dealing with threats of death was nothing new to Paul. He had been threatened many times, but all these threats failed to shake his faith. Paul's earlier life as a Pharisee, but even more since his conversion, had really strengthened his belief in the resurrection and in life beyond death. This gave him the confidence to speak out about things that many others might have avoided. Paul's only desire was to serve Christ. In this passage, Paul speaks of the fear of the Lord, not so much in the Old Testament meaning of it, but more as an expression of the awesomeness of Yahweh. Paul's conversion had brought him to see the amazing love of God shown through the life, the death, and the resurrection of Christ. Christ's sacrificial death for all meant that those who lived had to live in Christ and for Christ. This had become the main motivation for Paul's ministry. As a Pharisee, the claim that Christ was the Messiah had troubled Paul so much that he had become a very violent persecutor of the Christian community. But his meeting with the risen Christ had completely transformed his life. So Paul really truly understood the meaning and the fact that through this meeting, he had become a new creation. Reading from 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 6 to 17. So we are always confident, even though we know that while we are at home in the body, we are away from the Lord. For we walk by faith, not by sight. Yes, we do have confidence, and we would rather be away from the body and at home with the Lord. So whether we are at home or away, we make it our aim to please him. For all of us must appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each may receive recompense for what has been done in the body, whether good or evil. Therefore, knowing the fear of the Lord, we try to persuade others, but we ourselves are well known to God, and I hope that we are also well known to your consciences. We are not commending ourselves to you again, but giving you an opportunity to boast about us, so that you may be able to answer those who boast in outward appearance and not in the heart. For if we are beside ourselves, it is for God. If we are in our right mind, it is for you. For the love of Christ urges us on, because we are convinced that one has died for all. Therefore, all have died. And he died for all, so that those who live might live no longer for themselves, but for him who died and was raised for them. From now on, therefore, we regard no one from a human point of view. Even though we once knew Christ from a human point of view, we know him no longer in that way. So if anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away. See, everything has become new. As modern readers of the parables, we sometimes have difficulties because we often fail to think of them in spiritual terms. In today's passage, Jesus is speaking of the way that faith can provide a full and abundant life to those who believe and those who follow him. Growing up as a carpenter before he began his ministry, Jesus would no doubt have had a chance to speak to many farmers in Galilee. The cycle of seed time and harvest were very natural topics among them, I'm sure, just as they are today. In that region, there was very fertile soil for raising crops. The rainfall was plentiful, and so the crops did well. In fact, Jesus may quite well have helped some of his friends and neighbors with the harvest. It's very clear from some of his parables that he understood the cycle of growth, and he understood that a farmer needed to have both patience and faith as he waited for his crops to grow and mature. The second parable in the reading today, the parable of the mustard seed, is most certainly a bit of an exaggeration, but it does make a special point that a very small amount of faith can do great things. Reading from Mark chapter 4, verses 26 to 34. He also said, "The kingdom of God is as if someone would scatter seed on the ground and would sleep and rise night and day, and the seed would sprout and grow. He does not know how. The earth produces of itself first the stalk, then the head, then the full grain in the head. But when the grain is ripe, at once he goes in with his sickle, because the harvest has come." He also said, "With what can we compare the kingdom of God, or what parable will we use for it? It is like a mustard seed, which, when sown upon the ground, is the smallest of all the seeds on earth. Yet when it is sown, it grows up and becomes the greatest of all shrubs, and puts forth large branches, so that the birds of the air can make nests in its shade." With many such parables, he spoke the word to them, as they were able to hear it. He did not speak to them except in parables, but he explained everything in private to his disciples. This is the gospel of our risen Lord.
Last night I dreamed an angel came. He looked my way. He called my name. He bid me look the other way. I turned and heard my Savior say, "He said, if I be lifted up, I'll draw all men to me. He turned and then I saw the nail-scarred hands that bled for me. I touched the hem of his garment that fell around him there. My life, my heart, I gave, my soul was his care. When I awoke, my heart beat so, and in the dark I saw a glow. This was no dream. He looked my way. Again I heard my Savior say. He said, if I be lifted up, I'll draw all men to me. He turned and then I saw the nail-scarred hands that bled for me. I touched the hem of his garment that fell around him there. My life, my heart, I gave, my soul was in his care. My life, my heart, I gave, my soul was in his care.
In his ministry here on earth, Jesus told many parables. Several of these were about the kingdom of God, the spiritual kingdom, a kingdom that's present in the world today. Each of us, when saved by God's grace, becomes a subject of that spiritual kingdom. In this passage today, Jesus makes it clear that he intends to grow that kingdom, to build his church. Our human ideas on how this will happen are sometimes a little bit confusing and confused. Some people think that in order to let the kingdom grow, we need to become more like the world that it's growing in. While others think that we need to cut ourselves off entirely from the rest of the world in order for the kingdom to grow. The real answer to it is probably somewhere in the middle of that. In our reading today, Jesus presents us with a few of the principles of kingdom growth. Through these principles, he will grow his kingdom, and he invites us to be a part of that growth. The first principle is that kingdom growth involves a ministry. Notice in the passage today who it is that sows the seeds, as Jesus tells this parable. He says, the kingdom of God is as if someone would scatter seed on the ground. That someone is a person. God has chosen people, us, to grow his kingdom through a human ministry. God could very easily have chosen to use angels for this. Or God, with his strength and power, could have created some new, unknown being that could have spread these seeds of the kingdom. But he chose us. Each one of us who has been saved was saved because someone sowed gospel seeds. Whether that someone was a parent, a friend, a minister, an evangelist, somewhere someone planted a seed that fell into fertile soil. A seed that sprouted and grew, and a seed that produced new life within us, and a new life within us that is capable of producing more seeds to be spread. But also realize that once the seeds are sown, the farmer, the one spreading the seeds, has done pretty much all that he can do. Oh yes, he can fertilize the soil, he can water the plants, he can keep them free of weeds, but he can't make the seeds germinate. He can't make them be fruitful. All he can really do is place the seed into the soil and wait patiently. It's pretty humbling to realize how little control we have over the seeds that we plant. But we also know that God has placed everything that is needed within that seed. We can be patient because we can have faith that once the seed is planted, God can make it grow. The seed has the capability of germinating, of growing, of bearing fruit, all without our help. The gospel seeds that we plant, we can entrust to God to make them grow. We know that there are some people who hear the gospel message, the message that we share with them, who will reject it. Just as there is some soil that will not allow seeds to grow. It's not fertile. It's not able to provide the nourishment that's required for the seed. All we can do is spread the seed whenever we have a chance and trust God to prepare the soil so that it is fertile and ready. The second principle of kingdom growth is that it is a mystery. No one can really completely explain exactly how a dead, dormant seed can be buried in the soil and can produce life. Almost immediately after it's buried, the outer husk starts to absorb water from the soil and it starts to swell. Within a few hours, the chemical makeup of that seed begins to change, and a tiny root very soon starts to grow downward, and the beginning of a stalk starts to grow upward. It can happen very quickly, or if conditions aren't favorable at the time, it can remain dormant for a long time. Seeds of the gospel grow in the same way. They can begin to take root almost immediately, in minutes or in hours, or they may take years. But if the gospel seeds are planted, they can bring about new life. The seed is planted, it germinates, it begins to grow. The results of that may not be visible to the farmer for weeks. He doesn't know which of the seeds he planted will actually grow. He doesn't know whether the soil is going to be welcoming, going to be rich enough, going to be fertile enough to produce that growth. So he has to wait patiently. Just as we don't know the condition of the hearts that we plant gospel seeds in. Some of those seeds will sprout and grow, some will not. God tells us that that's not our concern. We don't try to judge whether we should plant the seeds or not. Our job is to plant the seeds and trust Him to prepare the soil, to prepare the hearts. Our job, plant the seeds. God's job, look after the harvest. The third principle of kingdom growth is that it involves a majesty. Reading verse 28, the earth produces of itself, first the stalk, then the head, then the full grain in the head. We see a progression in that growth. It starts off very small and very fragile. It would be very easy to crush it, to destroy it at that point. But as it grows and matures, it gets stronger, and it can multiply itself many times over. Just as a new believer is very fragile. They need time for their faith to mature and grow. But with time, the real promise, the real potential can be seen. And yet, even then, there's still plenty of growing to do. Finally, the full head of grain is visible and mature. This is the believer as they reach their spiritual maturity. They're strong, they're capable of reproducing the gospel seeds. This is the progression that God expects of us to first off become that fragile, delicate being, having faith, but faith that hasn't had time to develop. It's not strong yet. Going from that to a maturing but still incomplete faith. Finally, a faith that is ready. A faith that is willing to be shared with the rest of the world to spread more seeds. The real profit that comes from this crop is the honor that it brings to the Lord. Our goal, as we live for Him, should be to bring honor and glory to His name. As we think of this parable and the lessons from it, take time to ask yourself, if you are saved, are you sowing the gospel seeds as God asks you to? If you are saved, are you growing in a way that pleases the Lord, a way that will honor Him? Has the gospel seed been planted in your heart? Has that seed sprouted and taken root? Are you on your way to maturing, to producing seeds? Are you ready for God's harvest? Amen.
Turn.
Let us pray. Lord God, you place yourself in the affairs of mankind through Jesus, the Messiah, because no earthly leaders are able to redeem the world that you love so deeply. You have spoken, you will accomplish it. Heavenly Father, even as you planted the majestic trees, made them tall, so also you've brought us forth to bear fruit in every age, even in old age. Loving God, you hear our prayers. You live among us. Lord Jesus Christ, help us to look at you and others with the spiritual eyes of faith, knowing that we are your new creation. Even as you died and rose for us, urge us to live and to care for others. Your kingdom, Lord God, is a seed-planting kingdom. Help the kernel of life in every shell of every single body gathered for worship split and sprout like seed in good soil, always looking forward to your day of harvest. Holy Spirit, nations and leaders rise and fall like trees in a storm. In this age, give us the wisdom to depend on God's holy promises and commands as our primary guides in life. Help us minister to those who need their health restored, their hope invigorated, their love rekindled. Bring us a joy greater than happiness, a love beyond imagination, and may our last illness bring us to your throne of grace. Hear us as we pray for one another in the words that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. God calls us to step out in faith, to follow where he leads, even if what he calls us to do sometimes seems impossible. So let's go out into the world with courage, trusting in God's presence and power, and eager to do God's will. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all today and every day of your life. Amen.